Life is rough.
You gotta take the time to focus on what brings you joy.
As the Japanese say, ikigai.
Or, what am I nerding out about right now?
Join us at the gaming table.
Or reading nook.
To find your happiness.
I'm Laney.
I'm Marshall. And this is Elated Geek.
Welcome to Spinnerack Kids. I'm Corey.
I am Marshall.
And this is the not so full-throated episode. I'm a little under the weather, but we're going to charge through this episode on magic.
Yeah, so today we are doing Ain't That a Witch. This is all about magic and about magic schools and about magic orders. And we're going everywhere in magic except for Hogwarts.
So, the thing I've probably mentioned before is that I'm not a big horror guy. Marshall isn't really that much either. But when it comes to magic, I've grown more appreciative of it, especially in comics, I'd say over the last 10 years. It's an intriguing way to go, because when you read superheroes, there's so many tropes that can kind of get old after a while. But with magic, there's kind of like an endless imagination to it that you can go kind of anywhere.
It is literally the power of the imagination.
Yeah. I want to start with one, probably really the first magic story I ever got into, even pre-Harry Potter for me, which is Buffy the Vampire Slayer. And real quick, again, disclaimer about Joss Whedon. We do not condone anything he did or is accused of doing, any of that stuff. But Buffy's a very early fandom. For me, we're talking about the Boom kind of reboot, and when Boom acquired the comic rights to do Buffy, they really kind of took it and did a whole overhaul. In the previous, it had been under Dark Horse, which I'd read some of those books, and some of those books were like supposed to be official, like this is Buffy season 9, season 8.
All the way up to like season 13.
Yeah, which I was excited about, but ultimately disappointed by, because they kind of just went a little off the rails in my feeling. But I was excited to check out a new Buffy thing, and I was really pleased with what I found. It's not the best story I've ever read, but it's very cohesive. What they did is they rebooted the timeline in the way where basically characters that were introduced like maybe in season 3 or season 4, all are there in Sunnyvale at the same time, and they all kind of come together and meet in a little bit of different ways, and the characters have different storylines as well. But I really liked it. I thought they had a good capture of the tone, where there's a sense of humor to it. It's not written for full-blown comedy the way Joss's crew wrote it back then, but It's a good cohesive way to tell this story.
What I find really interesting in this, what we had read is something that happens, it's later in the stories. We missed a good chunk of the early portions, but this is also taking in stuff from the Angel comics, because they're starting to do some more crossover stuff. So this is Buffy and Angel, and the stories that we read were focused on the Hellmouth opening. And one of the things that I noticed right away was that they were no longer using the mundanes of the Scooby Gang as butt monkeys, as the trope goes. They didn't have Willow constantly being captured and victimized and everybody having to run to her aid, that was a whole thing about her.
Yeah.
In the show.
That's what I mean about them taking stuff from the later timeline in the series and really making it a part of the beginnings. Now, what he was talking about being a little bit later, we're talking probably five issues in for each comic. I picked this one because it was an actual crossover, one solid story, so that we could do it, as opposed to just...
And it showed the same event from a whole bunch of different perspectives, which is good.
Yeah. So there was basically, there was the Buffy comic, there was the Angel comic, and then there was a specific Hellmouth comic that these are done in. It was really enjoyable. When you have a good story, especially if it's based on something you know, and you just kind of can tell they have a good hand on it, you can relax into the story, which is what I did. The art is very fun, at times kind of cartoony a little bit. It's on the cartoonier side of, say, a superhero comic. I really enjoyed it. It's been really impressed by a lot of Boom art.
And the art was very, very good. I enjoyed that art.
Yeah, it was really good stuff. I tried to get into Angel multiple times in the series. Couldn't really do it. It was more the dynamic of the characters that they really needed maybe to... Unfortunately, one of the characters, one of the actors passed away early on in the series, so they really never gelled with a kind of dynamic... Maybe they should have had a funnier guy in there that would have worked better. But I really actually enjoyed this Angel comic. I really got a good handle on it. I liked the writing of one of the characters. He was kind of like a vigilante, just on his own, not a slayer. Yeah. But the way they portrayed him in here and the character Fred, all those things really worked really well together. I really enjoyed them.
Now, the next thing that we read, although... We read all of these at different times from each other. We read some of the comic books of the Dresden Files, and we didn't read any of them that were adaptations of the novels by Jim Butcher.
Right.
But he, being a big comic book fan himself, and actually Dresden, the character, is a big fan of comic books, you can know that he knows how to write for comic books.
Yeah, it's great. Dresden Files is a series that I found on Sci-Fi Channel a long time ago, just happened to have the right cable channel at the right time when it came out. Enjoyed it. Was, again, kind of in a Firefly way, disappointed when they canceled it.
Yeah.
Marshall never heard of it when I first moved out here and moved in with him, but it was right up his alley of what he think, and he's read all the books. I have yet to read any of the books, honestly. I've only read these comics. Marshall, it's his thing. You've read them, like, maybe twice?
I've read through the entire series 2 to 3 times.
Yeah. So I really hit a vein for him. He, like, really, really enjoys them. So I personally read Welcome to the Jungle. You read both Dogman and Welcome to the Jungle.
Yes.
And this is basically, it's like Humphrey Bogart noir, but it's set in modern day. And instead of just a detective, he's a full-blown warlock.
He's a wizard. Yeah.
Yeah, a wizard.
Magic doesn't make his life any easier. Just like Spider-Man, having Spider-Man powers doesn't make his life any easier. It only makes things worse. So you get this hard-boiled PI that's got magic.
A lot of sense of humor, too, though. Very sarcastic. Mm-hmm. Some of the significant things is he does work with the police as a consultant, but that's always like... the kind of grist for the mill, because, yeah, it's a love-hate thing, because there's only one person that works for the police that really relies on him, because it's, you know, the unexplained, the paranormal, they don't know what to do with it.
Karen Murphy.
And then he has this great character, one of the great characters in genre fiction of all time, and that's Bob, right?
Bob the Skull.
Bob, yes. The Skull, yeah. I don't know, in the book, is he always in the skull in the books?
Bob is a spirit of intellect. He is composed of spirit, energy, and air. The sunrise will actually just wipe them out if they don't have shelter. And gotcha. That skull is his shelter.
In the series, there is an actual actor that comes out of the skull, almost kind of like a genie in that sense, where they're at a house, but it comes out. Because they couldn't really, I mean, it would have been really ridiculous just to have a voiceover on a skull. That would be one of the most boring visuals. Yeah,
they just have an LED light inside of a skull and call it a day.
But it's great because he's got kind of like, it's kind of like he's Alfred in a way. It's very much a Batman and Alfred dynamic with Bob and Harry Dresden. He's very sarcastic.
Now, the other thing that I do see in this writing, these comics are actually canon for the stories. So Dogman is referenced later in the books, but I had no idea what he was talking about until I just read this. I'm like, oh, that makes sense. But even better yet, like, because they're both being written by Jim Butcher, the tonality of how the characters are written are so spot on that as I'm reading it, I am hearing James Marsters.
Yes, James Marsters would be known as Spike from Buffy the Vampire Slayer and from the series. He's also played Brainiac in Smallville. This guy is the guy. I mean, he does such a good job.
Yeah.
In fact, when I think I first heard the audiobooks, which is how both of us read them, is I thought it was actually the actor from the series when I first heard it. Jim Butcher's just very careful with his stuff. I don't think he lets it go without him being able to be a consultant on the projects.
Yeah.
So just a really good translation of the books. The art is really solid in Welcome to the Jungle. It's done. I'm not going to say it has the best depictions of action, but character work, very, very, very solid.
Yes.
Now we're going to move on to Doctor Strange. Doctor Strange is a character I'd heard the name of all my life. Basically, he started in like the 60s and 70s. Everybody's so sure the creators of Doctor Strange were on many things, when they created Doctor Strange, his visuals and everything. I think I've said on here, there's a clear demarcation timeline-wise, history-wise. I can't go back and read certain books. They're just too... The writing of it. It's not the art. It's never the art, really. It's the writing of it. It's just overblown. But, again, we're going to mention this guy that we've read in when we talked about Southern Bastards, when we talked about Star Wars. Same author here, Jason Aaron.
Mm-hmm.
Great writer, really adaptable. I mean, when he writes his own stuff, he definitely has a tone when he does his indie stuff. But when he adapts, he's like, I'm taking this character seriously.
Yeah.
I'm going to do my best version. Or he sometimes calls it his fanfic version of it.
Yeah.
But he really considers the character.
The one that we read of the Doctor Strange series, we read one called The Way of the Weird.
Yes.
And in this, Doctor Strange begins by just doing what he do, and then this librarian shows up at his doorstep with psychic parasites, and it all kind of goes bizarre from
literally
there.
Like she takes it's this isn't just like the visual of it. She takes off her beanie and there are all these things in her head. One of the things I had to comment on, like, the art is great. It's done very cartoony.
Yes.
A lot of times, but it never takes away from the horror, but it also is done in an overblown way. So it's not, I said that there was a lot of humor and a lot of grossness as a part of the story. But one thing I wanted to comment on too is just one of the covers in this trade of The Way of the Weird is literally, there's a whole comment about like what they eat and what's in Doctor Strange's fridge. And when you see the cover, it's literally the open fridge door with those old fashioned like preschool plastic letters that say Jason Aaron and the Bachalo, the artist as well, just like but they're like almost 3D. It looks like they literally took a picture and just put them on there. I just thought that was a nice touch.
And what was also really fun about this was whenever he opened his third eye, his spiritual sight, it took everything that was normal world and it removed all of its coloration and all of its shading, and it just made it outlines. And then the spirituality of what was around him not only appeared, but appeared in full vibrant colors.
So you could see the parallel. Saturated. You could see like the spiritual right alongside the material. And also, what you talked to me about earlier is you actually see he has a third eyelid.
Yeah, he has a complete vertical eye that goes on
vertical,
his face,
and like you see his third eye. So again, that's part of that is kind of weird. There's a weird aspect to it, but the way it's done is kind of cartoony as well. So they basically, Aaron said, I want to get a whole new generation of people liking Doctor Strange.
And I think
so
he succeeded.
We don't want to go full, let's go conjuring with it. Mm-hmm. Let's do it in a way that, you know, even younger kids could probably get into it. I really liked it. Now, he didn't read it, but I had to go back and read it just because I picked it up on, I think, a free comic book day or something.
And I read that. I know I read
yeah,
that.
Yeah, you read the first issue of it. It's Doctor Strange, The Oath, which is Brian K. Vaughan, and I believe it's Marcos Martin, but I'm not positive. But just, it's a more traditional take, I would say. The way he talks, the way he relates to women, in a way, it's misogynistic a little bit, but he'll say things like, my dear, when he's talking to the night nurse and all that stuff. But the art in this is just gorgeous. It's the same team behind this indie book called The Private Eye, which Brian K. Vaughan did starting on his own just like label. So I just wanted to go back because I knew I loved it. And we actually had a little bit of delay in our production time, so I went back and read it. It basically, it's really kind of using the night nurse, which is a character I'd never heard of. Again, I wasn't
but
a Marvel.
But she does appear in the Daredevil Netflix series.
Yes, yes. And that's, so I'd heard about her, I'd read about her in this book. And then later, yes, the wonderful Rosario Dawson plays her in that. So it's basically like he shows that there is literally a building in New York City where the superheroes come to get stitched up. You got the, it starts off with the Iron Fist and a young girl who somehow was related to the Spider-Verse, I guess, and just kind of sitting and talking, waiting to go in. And then all of a sudden, you get Doctor Strange and his guy Wong bringing Doctor Strange in with a bullet wound, and
yeah, Wong is kind of like his gal Friday.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. as you see, if you're familiar with the movies, you can see they beefed up his role because that guy said, "I'm not going to be anybody's manservant. That's not happening."
I really like the MCU Wong a lot better. Yeah. Although, seeing how he is in Way of the Weird, there's this secret side that even he keeps from Doctor Strange, and I'm like, that's really interesting.
It's better realized in Way of the Weird. It definitely is. Like I said, the oath is a little bit more traditional, but what Brian K. Vaughn captured here was at least an emotional connection between the two and a mm-hmm. loyalty between the two that it was really good. I really enjoyed
it. Yeah, because even if he is a quote-unquote manservant, he is Doctor Strange's best friend, and Doctor Strange will go to the ends of the earth for this dude.
It's like a blood oath, too. It's like thing where, like, they kind of both have it for each other, even though technically it's the Wong side is, like, has to protect him at all costs. So, really good, really just gorgeous art. Tying into this, I was really excited when I started to see ads for this thing called Strange Academy. Now, I get excited by all ages comic books just because, and when I say all ages, it means more for kids. If they're done right, they're great. And for me, when I've had to tromp through CSI, you know, storytelling where literally the only purpose of a hero is just to tell his exposition, and it's either written from just exposition, okay, this is what's happening, this is what, you know, it's all strategic, just mm-hmm. war room kind of talk, or it's, you know, junior high playground fight talk. I just get tired of that. So when somebody can really nail an all ages book, and it seems like in the last, I would say definitely 10 years, there has been a push for all ages books that are higher quality. So I got excited that they were doing the Strange Academy. So this is a young, I would say early teen, maybe junior high, the school, they're probably early teens, I would say maybe at the max 14 years old, and it's Doctor Strange post Way of the Weird. It's even the same artist doing a school to train the next generation, because what has happened in Way of the Weird is, like, there's a whole force, which you can't really get into the whole of because we only read basically probably half of the story, trying to take away magic. Mm-hmm. And so Strange basically says, okay, you know, we need Dumbledore's army this and get some kids, the next generation of fighters, because we're going to need to battle this.
And what I really enjoyed about this is the number of different characters they brought in. They brought in Dr. Warlock, who only very recently started becoming popular because for a little while he was the Sorcerer Supreme. Mm. You have Scarlet Witch. You have all these different characters, and they're all just professors, and the kids themselves are fantastic and magically powerful in their own rights. One of them is Dormammu's son.
Yeah. Just to mention, they also even have Agatha Harkness, from which you'll see in WandaVision, yes, which we'll talk about later, is in there as well.
At the end of each chapter, they have documents from that are on the desks of the teachers, which just give you further fleshing of things that are going on in between the stories, as all of these kids are being kids in magic.
Yeah.
And it's a dark magic.
Yeah, Marshall is really big on the interstitial stuff. Usually I struggle to finish all of these things in a timely manner, so I kind of skip past that stuff. I appreciate that it was there. Saw these little pages of what they're doing. I thought, anytime you can take approach like that and just add a little layer to it, so great.
On the other side of things, though, DC did their own Magical Academy series books called Mystic U, and this one felt very different.
It was a mini series. I was really bummed because I thought, oh, this is going to be an ongoing, it's going to go for a while, at least get a good, you know, at least 30 issues out of it, and it never realized. So Mystic U, obviously the U is university, so they're older. So this is Zatanna. Her father gets into trouble and she wants to help him out, so she ends up being contacted by this university. You know, I really enjoyed it. I even enjoyed it this time around, but there's always this nagging thing. I was like, I just want more of this story. I just love this kind of setup.
When it comes to DC, I've always kind of had a difficult time with their magic characters. Many of them I wasn't interested in, except for Zatanna and Jason Blood, who is Etrigan. The demon Etrigan.
Yes.
And so those two characters are the only ones that I was ever really interested in. This book didn't make me all that interested in any new ones, but it at least wasn't boring. It was kind of cool, and it interfaces well with something else that we read very recent that was also DC.
The moment I saw a cover that said Justice League Dark, I'm like, what is that? Because for me, again, like I said, the tropes of superhero stuff I've been reading all my life, and just what does the dark mean? Does it mean, because for me, if it's just, oh, they turned villainous, kind of not that interesting. But when I found out, no, oh, it's magic, they're bringing magic in. Now, for those of you who don't know the DC histories, their indie, what they call an imprint, their side label, has been Vertigo. In recent years, they decided, probably through financial reasons, to consolidate. And when they did that with Vertigo, they basically said, okay, everybody's fair game. Everybody that was introduced in Vertigo, which was much more adult, darker stories for the most part, is now a part of the DCU. So
they Constantine.
They bring in Constantine into Justice League Dark. So if you, I don't know if you've seen the Keanu Reeves movie, that's who this character is. He's actually British. There's been two great movies in the animated series that they do movies. I really enjoy his character. And yeah, this Justice League Dark, it's creepy. It's really good. I do enjoy it. What was your take on it?
The ones that we read specifically, one of them is called The Last Age of Magic, and the other one was Lords of Order. Now, those of you who listened to the book podcast with me and Laney, I kind of mentioned these two books and how they were much better writings of another fantasy book. I got it from Corey to read, and I told him don't bother with it. It was Dr. Fate, Volume 1 and 2 by J.M. DeMatteis. Now, this is almost the same exact plot line, but in the one that is analogous to Dr. Fate number 1, which is The Last Age of Magic, the villains are so creepy. They're basically these Lovecraftian horrors that are gaining strength as more people are passing around the story of what they are. They're invading the fiction verse, basically, to become more powerful.
Are they the underkind? Is that what it is?
Other kind. The second one...
Upside down with a right side up creepy grin. They literally just walk upside down. It's really creepy.
One of them is, yeah. They're all different. Then the other book, The Lords of Order, is Dr. Fate Volume 2, where the Lords of Order go crazy. And now superheroes have to come around and become new Lords of Order. And James Tynion took over and did these, and you can see the parallels directly between those stories. But, oh my goodness, this boy can write.
Yeah. There's been, I'd say since 2005, right around there, it was the ushered in what I call the new golden age of comics, where the indie market, specifically Image Comics, pushed the other, the big two, Marvel and DC, to get better. And they kind of, the indie comics became the farm team for the big two. And what I love about it is it's not just punk rock, let's tear everything down. It's like, no, we grew up with this stuff. We love this stuff. Let's write this stuff and give this stuff validity, which is kind of what the MCU did to everything. And there's this character who I don't think I would have ever read. I was anti-camp as a kid. As a little kid, I liked the Batman 66 show, but I did not like the old Star Trek. So that kind of stuff would kind of turn me off. So as a teenager, even if I ever saw this guy on a cover, I would be like, who is this? But Detective Chimp, as written in these Justice League Dark books, he's so great, and he's basically the best way to describe him. He's the Rocket Raccoon of this universe.
Kind of.
But in the MCU, it was definitely written with a lot more gravity of dramatic, and that's kind of the way he is in this, is what Detective Chimp is this. So he's literally got a Sherlock cap. He is a chimpanzee.
He runs a bar.
He runs this bar, yeah, that he's taken over for a friend of his that died. Just great. I mean, he's the perfect foil. You need, that's one thing I was talking about with Angel, you need humor to leaven this, mm-hmm. this darkness, and he is so great at it.
But I also want to bring up, even though these are all kind of separated by time, they're doing things at different times, you are seeing very similar storylines going on here. In Way of the Weird, it's about these villains that are coming in and they're eating magic. In Justice League Dark, Lovecraftian horrors are coming in from another dimension eating magic. Strange Academy, they're getting all these kids together because magic got messed up. Mystic U, they're getting all these kids together because magic is messed up. They're very parallel storylines, which just kind of goes back to the whole Marvel versus DC comics, where they're two different sides of the same
coin. Yeah, and I Ant-Man and the Atom. You know, yeah. There's always a thing. But to me, if they push them to do better stories, I don't really care. I'm not one of those people that's going to sit online all day and go, well, that's just that, and that's just that, because that's a dumb argument. And if it's done well, it's good.
They are actually very different in how they're doing what they're doing. Personally, I prefer Strange Academy to Mystic U, but I like Justice League Dark better than I like Way of the Weird.
Wow. And see, I would agree with you. I had hopes for Mystic U. I think it could have gotten, if they'd have given it a shot, could have gotten better. But Strange Academy out the gate was just great, beautiful. With Strange Academy, one thing we didn't mention is the writer, Scotty Young, mm-hmm. who was mainly known as an artist. If you ever have seen any of the Wizard of Oz books that Marvel did a while back.
Very whimsical.
Beautiful, beautiful cartoonishness. Just kind of, like you said, whimsical. Just, it's a perfect way to describe it. So he actually wrote this, but did not draw it. But they got a compatible artist. The art is very compatible to his style of writing, and it's great stuff. So moving along, another series that I got into first and introduced Marshall too. I wasn't sure. This one started off really kind of dark.
It kind of stayed dark too.
Yeah, it did, but it seemed to have more of a point as it went. I literally listened to this as an audiobook. I had a friend that I was working with that was reading it, and I listened to it in the audiobook, and it just, if the characters are kind of douchey, that can actually turn me off. If it's just a bunch of people just around just being sarcastic and douchey, I like sarcasm, but if it's done in a light way, it's fine. But this just seems like, who are these people? And I don't really like any of these characters when I read the actual novel. I'm the one that kind of tries out a lot of TV, and so I tried out The Magicians on Sci-Fi.
This is like Narnia meets Harry Potter and gets drunk.
Yeah, so the reason why I say it's graduate school, so this guy, Lev Grossman, wrote these books. It's like he was probably like, you can almost feel the like frustration with how popular Harry Potter was in the way he writes this. It's like, I'm going to do everything they didn't do and just go, okay, this is going to be older so I can put sex and drugs and stuff into it. But when we watch the series, the actors really sold it. They really did. And it gets really dark at times.
But like, it's also very heartfelt.
Yeah, for sure. Like,
oh, you fall in love with these characters.
Yeah, if you get past the first season, but just some of the cleverest stuff, there's stuff that's how magic is with the internet, how that interfaces, great stuff. I would say I won't even talk about that, but this book here is actually kind of post what we've seen, I believe, in the series. It's just another class.
It's
called
a little
Magicians,
difficult to
class.
Tell because The Magicians does a whole lot of time travel and alternate timeline stuff.
That's true.
So this could have been anywhere. It could have been after. It could have been before. We don't know.
But it has the dean, right?
It does have the dean, so it could have been before. And he looks a little younger.
Yeah. So why don't you talk about your impression of this book? I thought they did a good job of just doing it.
Yeah, the main plot of it is that there apparently is this group that is stealing really, really scary magic books from everywhere. So the dean of Breakbill's Magic College gets a whole bunch of hedge witches, people that couldn't get into his school, brings them in and says, hey everybody, we're going to learn battle magic so you can punch these guys in the face with a magic missile. And there is plot going on here I don't really want to spoil some of it, but it was in the same feeling, almost felt like it was rehashing some of the characteristics, but the characters were very much in the same vein. There is a character who is trans, and you kind of get to feel for some of their plight here.
Yeah, I was pleased to find out that it actually wasn't a translation of the characters from the comics.
Yes.
In fact, that it was well-written enough, and they decided to go with just a different class. I like that, because I always want kind of more and new. And because The Magicians has done its run, I believe it's still on Netflix, so you definitely check it out. But yeah, I did like that it was its own little
side story.
Yeah, I really, really enjoyed it. It's Archaea Comics, which is like a prestige line of comics. They don't just throw stuff out there.
Well, that's interesting, because Archaea also published this book. This is one of the things that's on my TBR list. It's Jim Henson's Labyrinth novelization.
Nice. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, Archaea, they're legit. Yeah, they do have some kind of contract connection with Henson, because they took an old script from a movie that he never produced and turned it into a comic.
Awesome.
Yeah, so you can see we love all ages books. This one I just found online, and I was really impressed with it. Knew nothing about anything about it, but it just, the art grabbed me, and it was a magical book, so we threw it in here. It's called Courtney Crumrin. That's Crumrin. It's not the easiest thing to say.
No.
But it's about a young girl who moves to her grandfather's house, which is actually always kind of a great setup. Even if you've seen it tons of times, there's a lot of potential for someone to have to relocate. There's a book called Amulet, book series called Amulet, that we'll bring in maybe in a later magic thing, the same kind of setup. And I just enjoyed it. They did a really good job of making her kind of sullen, but she's not annoying. She's not that kind of annoying. She's probably preteen, I would say maybe 12, maybe 13.
She's very antisocial.
Antisocial, which I was a kid that moved a lot when I was a kid, so I can understand that. I really felt that dynamic. And the art was super simple and strong. It just was really great. Like, there's a lot of mystery to what her grandfather does and the magic aspects of it. And then there's magical creatures just outside the property in the woods. And I just really enjoyed it. What did you think?
I was kind of torn. I was like, this artist, this writer should actually be somewhat proud of himself. The artist is the writer. His name is Ted Naifeh. And this was his first thing that he ever did.
Wow.
And he isn't bad for a first time. That being said, I felt like a lot of the things that he was doing was things that I have seen before. And the artwork, while it had it was very distinct and very characteristic, and it brought out lots of stuff, it wasn't very refined. And this is his first thing.
Yeah.
He's going to get better. So he has a good starting point, but I'm not entirely certain if it was enough to fully capture me.
Well, it is a series, too, so
yes.
I'm going to go on.
We read The Night Things out of that, but there's like two other ones.
Yeah, the first volume. So I'm definitely intrigued enough, because to me, simplicity is welcome. Like, I've been talking about these all ages books where things are just overblown a lot of times in the superhero world. A simple story with a heartfelt connection to a character, that's all I need.
Now, that being said, like, you can have very simple artwork that is still refined.
Yeah.
It's all about being steady, knowing your technique. And that does come with time. If you're just getting into it, you don't build that up yet.
Well, it's kind of funny, too, because I mentioned this. I actually showed this to Laney, which Laney doesn't read a lot of comics. She's starting to get into now, where she's reading on the Walking Dead show. And I found some other books like Babysitter's Club that she's been reading. But I showed her the art from Sweet Tooth, which is a series we've been reading, which we won't get into now, but we can maybe talk about later. Jeff Lemire, like, never let his non-traditional art style, or maybe lack of full art training stop him.
Yeah.
He just learned and got his own distinctive style. And I'm really impressed. Some of his books, like, I might not go back and read them ever, but like the fact that he was a writer and artist and just said, I don't have an artist that I can work with maybe, or I'm not at that point in my career where I can network. He just did it, and it's the simplest black and white artwork you've ever seen, but he caught emotion, and the writing was so great. So yeah, that's what I felt from Courtney Crumrin. This one is a tricky one. I won't get into it a whole lot, but I wasn't sure if we should put this in here. It's a series that I've read the whole thing and I love. Fables by Bill Willingham. The reason why I wasn't sure is there is magic for sure in it, but it's more in the background. It is, Fables is basically all the fairy tale characters in one universe. And you're like, oh, like Once Upon a Time in Grimm? No, this predates it, and they all stole from it.
Literally.
And yeah, this is so worth looking into. If you like universes and you want to see kind of like that kind of setup, it's so well written. It's very straight ahead. It's not super complex, but it captures emotional well. Captures sarcasm well. It's basically the main characters in this one are, there's Snow White and the big bad wolf, who's known as Bigby, who's a detective. They live in this place called Fabletown, where they basically hidden themselves away in New York City through magic. They had to exile from their original homelands because of a villain. And that's literally where it set it up. So it's kind of like almost in the middle of something that you'll get into later.
And they have their own apartment complex. And it's like, it's in New York and it's a ritzy one. So they have a doorman. And nearby, they have a number of businesses that belong to them that would be totally normal. Like Humpty Dumpty has a breakfast restaurant.
Right, and they even incorporate the fact that because of their exile, there are also magic animal characters, talking animals, and because they can't function in our natural world, they actually put them in upstate New York on a farm, and some of them are frustrated and try to come down and all that kinds of really good, straight ahead. It's not an interpretation, really. I mean, other than making them a little bit more human than they are in the fairy tales, like Prince Charming is a total douchebag. Total douchebag, right?
Totally fits for his character.
In fact, I think he's the Prince Charming for every princess, if I remember right. That's kind of where it goes. Really just fun. And this one, the first arc that we read is a murder mystery. And I just love it. The art is, for me, it's gorgeous. It's like Lichtenstein, if you've ever seen it in that pop art stuff. It's done in that style. I really loved it. For me, again, if you can nail simple comic art, so many people try to do it and don't get there. It was in Vertigo Comics. Just great stories. I highly recommend it. This sounds like, if you're into Disney lore but you want to read stuff and they're a little bit more grown up, this is great. And it's got like, it goes 100 issues, and there's a Jack character who's the Jack from every fairy tale. Jack be Nimble, all the Jacks, Jack and the Giant.
And when I started reading this, yeah, these covers that they have were absolutely gorgeous. I then get in there and the artwork, it's on par with a lot of the superhero artwork that you saw of the era. There was a little bit of roughness to it, but then you got certain shots where somebody just loved what they were doing, and it was superb comic book artwork. I kind of live for that. I really like the reinterpretations of some of these characters. I like the reinterpretation of Bigby and Goldilocks. What? Goldilocks was probably one of the best villainous characters I've seen in a little while.
Wait till you get to see Cinderella as basically Black Widow. She's a spy.
Oh, not Cinderella. I didn't see Cinderella. I did see Sleeping Beauty, though. Yeah. That was fun.
Yeah, so it's really fun. Like, a lot of what we talked about here is a little bit more darker in tone. This is not
really dark in tone,
but I actually appreciated that after reading a lot of indie books that were maybe a little too dark for my taste. This was a great one. Of all things, the place where you get Sandman and a lot of the darker stuff, Constantine, all that stuff, you actually get a book here that you can just blaze through and have fun with. I really highly, highly recommend Fables.
Although, speaking of dark, we have Magic Order.
Yeah, Mark Millar. Actually, it's Mark Millar, I found
Mark
out
Miller.
Recently
okay.
on Kevin Smith's Fat Man Beyond. It's Mark Millar, yeah, the Scottish guy who brought you Kick-Ass. I saw Magic Order, and it sounds good. It's literally like people hovering over a city on the cover. I'm like, oh, I'll check this out. And it seems like it's a mini. I don't know if they're going to go anywhere
from
this.
Yeah, I'm not entirely interested in seeing more of it, but it was good as a mini. Like,
yeah.
that was a good enough story by itself.
The writing and the art was really great. Good quality characterization of a dysfunctional family. They're all magic-based family. One, you know, there's the black sheep that's left, and just kind of the dynamics of where their place is. They basically are part of this governing body of magic, and how they deal with that when people start dying and stuff like that. I definitely enjoyed it. It's definitely on the R side of
books. Yeah, it's really dark, and there is some mature content going on here. But the art does make up for that, and the realism of the characters in the universe does kind of make up for that. So what I had to object to it was totally made up for by all the good stuff, and then some. So I still give this is like one of my 4 stars.
Yeah, he recently made a deal with Netflix, which the first project we were not impressed with and actually ultimately got canceled, which is Jupiter's Legacy. He actually has Netflix all over the books now. You see, he's got his own label of comics, but we'll see. There's a lot of hope. If I think maybe he needs to be more involved in the writing of the shows and not let that go by the wayside, because there's definitely talent here, and there's definitely possibilities. So we want to finish with a book from, I don't believe we talked about these series of books yet. Basically, DC was really on the move to cover all the demographics of their readers, be it young. They even had a whole different label for each demographic, be the young kid, teen, all that stuff. That has kind of gone by the wayside. But one of the things they've done is just hiring novelists, famous novelists, to take a stab at one character for a graphic novel. They've done a Batman one. They've done a bunch of different ones. They've done a Beast Boy one. This one is Raven by Cami Garcia.
And Cami Garcia also did the one for Beast Boy. And there's one that's coming up later this year, or it may already be out, is Beast Boy Loves Raven. So I'm really looking forward to that, because this is well written, I'm going to say. It was well written.
Yeah. Wonder of wonders that a female author could capture a teenage female high school experience. I mean, it was great. A lot of times, you know, in the past, they've had male writers trying to capture this stuff. They sometimes mixed results. But this one, I thought, was really good introduction to her character from good human perspective of what it's like to be Raven. I really enjoyed it. The art in all of these books is very simplistic on purpose. It's very, I won't say monochromatic, but it's basically they do a lot of black and white, and they pick maybe one or two signature colors to go with it. So like with the Batman book, the young Bruce Wayne book, basically, you know, it was basically blacks and grays and yellows, because that's kind of like his costume.
And in Raven, they're using purple, and they don't just go, well, we're stuck with this color palette, I guess we're gonna have to do it. They think how they're gonna do it, and they're very strategic about its placement and how it's talking here.
And for me, like, I've never yet been to this city that I have a lot of love for the culture of, but New Orleans has been wisely used recently. It was used in the Cloak and Dagger series, and it's also used in this as the setting, because there's a lot of magic and a lot of, like, you know, they do ghost tours. There's a lot of supernatural, spiritual. I mean, that's one of the founding cities of this country. So there's a lot to pull from there, and I thought that was a really good use of setting for this. So we hadn't talked about it yet, although we finished it a while ago, but I thought it was appropriate. I wanted to bring in a Scarlet Witch comic, but I couldn't really find one that I needed to do a little bit more deep digging. Maybe we'll find one for next time. But WandaVision, you know, everybody knows about it. It was a tough sell for me initially, because I kind of got what they were doing at the beginning, but as it got deeper into it, I would say you'd have to wait halfway through to get past what they were doing with the old TV trope, decades trope thing. I like that how they ultimately introduced why these TV tropes were happening, that there was a personal connection with Wanda. But as it went, it was fun to see for the first time, other than Doctor Strange, full-blown magic being used in the MCU. They pulled it out at the end, but yeah, what did you think?
I am not like what you seem to think a lot of people are. I feel like I got that very first episode. Within a few seconds, they had me. And then as that episode went on, they just gripped me. And they didn't lose me the entire season. That it was excellent. The only one that has surpassed it so far is Loki.
Yeah.
Loki is amazing.
So, yeah, that's great. I really hope we can find a good arc. It might be House of M. I don't know.
That's the closest I can think of, but I don't really know Scarlet Witch in the comics very well.
Yeah, so we'll maybe try to find something that we can talk about if we come. I think we're going to loop back around to these genres again and again until we find maybe a better way to do this show. But another just fun thing we discovered recently on Disney Plus is a kids cartoon called Owl House, and it's just a really fun, basically kind of an Alice in Wonderland-ish kind of
yeah,
thing, where this girl goes into, she's teenage, probably 12-13, goes into this magical world, and she really wants to learn and be taught by this witch that's there. And then there's this little, is he a demon?
He's a demon.
A little, yeah, demon guy with basically, he has kind of like an animal skull on top of his head.
He looks like he's a black version of a Cubone out of Pokemon. But
yeah,
like,
yeah,
what
that's true.
What I liked about this, because we only watched the first episode of it so far, but the main character is this super imaginative girl, and she's so imaginative that they're sending her to a summer camp to learn how to become normal. Oh, I wanted to punch some people.
Oh, yeah. That sounds all too familiar about certain social issues. But it was just a lot of fun. The guy that played the little demon is the Gravity Falls creator.
Mm-hmm.
And this actually, if you were a Gravity Falls fan, this totally falls in line with that. Mm-hmm. I believe the creator of the show worked on Gravity Falls, doing storyboard, and we want whatever the next thing is from the Gravity Falls guy,
yeah,
because we just love that series so much. So it's a really great, and it's on Disney Plus, so definitely check that out. That is going to be it for this week with our magic books. Hope you enjoy what we do. We're finding our way through it. Just happy to have Marshall reading comics. It's been my goal for years, even without having a podcast in mind. I'm sure he's enjoying getting
it. Yeah, just giving me some time to actually read comics, because I just don't often have a huge amount of time to sit down and look at something. I typically have to go through audiobooks.
And of course, I pick the time when he's on a book reading podcast to make him read more books.
Hey man, you got me to beat my Goodreads goal in half the year.
That's true.
So thank you for listening to Elated Geek. Follow us on social media for pictures and more info on things we talked about in today's podcast. You can find Laney on @ZaneyLaney or me @OneTrueHazard. You can also find @ElatedGeek on our Instagram. And you can also find ElatedGeekTweets on Twitter. If you want to go to a website, we have www.ElatedGeek.com. Links for these are in the show notes.
If you want to help us to continue to bring you new and exciting things to nerd out about, please consider donating to our Ko-fi account. The link is in the show notes, and every donation is accepted with total appreciation for your support in us.
Send us your geek obsessions or topics that you want us to experience and talk about in future episodes. Email us at share@elatedgeek.com.
And until next time,
geek out.